Welcome to Learning English with Captain Binoy Varangil, Assistant Professor, Department of English, St. Joseph's College, Devagiri, Kozhikode, Kerala. Today we discuss one of the chapters from Ways with Words, the textbook A02 English course meant for the first year degree students, first semester degree students of the colleges of University of Calicut. Today we discuss one of the important chapters, and the name of the chapter is It Used to be Green Once. This chapter, It Used to be Green Once, is a story, and it is written by Patricia Grace. Patricia Grace is a very important writer of 20th century. She, in fact, is a Maori writer in English. She belongs to the indigenous community of New Zealand, the Maori community, and the very language of the people is Maori. Let's right now have a discussion and understanding of the biographical details of Patricia Grace. Patricia Grace is a novelist, short story writer, and a writer of children's literature from New Zealand. She is a Maori writer in English. Her first short story collection was Wairarki in 1975, which won the Penn Hubert Church Award for the best book of fiction. The other short story collections include The Dream Sleepers and Other Stories of 1980, Electricity and Other Stories of 1987, Selected Stories of 1991, The Sky People of 1994, and Small Holes in the Silence of 2006. She collaborated with the artist Robin Kakuya to create several illustrated works for children like The Queer and the Spider of 1981, Waterless Tuna and the Children of Champion Street, and Wahine Toa of 1984. Her first novel was Mutu Wenua, The Moon Sleeps, 1978, which tells the tale of a Maori woman married to a Pakeha. A Pakeha is a white settler. Her other novels are Potiki of 1986, Cousins of 1992, Baby No Eyes of 1998, Dog Side Story 2001, Thu 2004, and Chappie 2015. Her work, Dog Side Story, was longlisted for the Booker Prize in 2001. She also Newstead International Prize for Literature in 2008. Now let's understand a little bit about the Maori language and Maori culture, and the word Maori and certain Maori words, and the background of the story It Used to be Green Once. The literal meaning of the word Maori is normal, and Maori people meant normal people who shared a common language and culture. They have been subdivided into various tribes. The European white settler was called Pakeha by the Maoris, and New Zealand was called Aotearoa. Maori became an official language in 1987 in New Zealand. Most of Maori literature exists in the oral form, and the body of written literature is comparatively small. Maori literature in English makes use of expressions from the tribal language, to thus making it a hybrid language. Maori way of life places importance to cultural values like love, which is aroha in Maori, hospitality, which is manaki tanga in Maori, people, which is te tangata, relationships, wanaunga tanga, and ancestors, nga tipuna, most of which are manifest in the works of Patricia Grace too. It Used to be Green Once has been taken from her collection, The Dream Sleepers and Other Stories of 1980. It tells about the ordinary everyday lives of the Maori community, not how possessions are not as valued as relationships within the community in the story. We can notice differences between the approach of the adults and the children. We also cannot the style of using of English shifting from the colloquial in the story. Also, we notice the shift from I to we in the narration of the story, and this story can be read as an attempt to capture the Maori cultural identity. In this story, Patricia Grace does not let the Maori identities erode. She even retains Maori names like Rana, Peti, and Kiri instead of the Pakeha names given at school. Now, with this biographical introduction and short introduction to the beautiful story, It Used to Be Green Once, let us have a discussion of this beautiful story, It Used to Be Green Once. I'll be reading from there and here. Some of the chapters from the story is going to be read out. In between, I'll be just telling you the very gist of the story as well. So this story, It Used to Be Green Once by Patricia Grace, helps us understand the very impoverished life of the family of the narrator, Patricia Grace. And we have to understand that she is representing the indigenous people of New Zealand, the Maori people. Maori is a group of indigenous, a particular indigenous community in New Zealand, and the very language of the people is Maori. And we have to understand the fact that the name of this indigenous group, Maori, comes from the very language the people use. And we understand that later in the 20th century, Maori has been accepted as an official language of New Zealand. Now let's look at the chapter, It Used to Be Green Once. So this chapter tells us about the family of Patricia Grace. We see that Patricia Grace has 14, in fact there are 14 children, and we understand the life of the children and their parents from the perspective of Patricia Grace, who is one among the 14 children. Now that there are 14 children, and the family is rather poor and impoverished, their parents have a lot of difficulty in bringing up the kids. We can see the difficulty of the parents in bringing up the kids from the beginning till the end of the story. We see how they are upset about going to school because they don't have proper clothing. They also do not have proper food. They don't have a proper bag. They don't have footwears or shoes at all. And often they are being ridiculed by their friends because of their impoverished background. Still, their parents are working hard, and they just ask them to go to school because they know that from the story we understand that their parents know the significance of education, and they are compelling their children to go to school every day and get educated. And now this story is also noticed for the humor in it. It is a very comic and very funny kind of a story. We have a lot of instances in which we are just bursting into hilarious laughter. Say, for example, in the opening of the story, we are told about the swimming suits the mother of the 14 children, including Patricia Grace, make for the children. And some of them are just very small, and they're just 10 years, and mother is making 38 size of togs or swimming suits for the children, and they are reluctant to go to the school. So this is quite shameful for them, wearing a swimsuit which is not suitable for them, not fitting to them. Other than that, so much of fun result from the family car. They have a car, and the car is not theirs. They did not buy the car. Their uncle Raj, who was in Auckland, just gave the car to them, and this car has no brake. And their mother, Patricia's mother, uses the car for shopping on Wednesdays, and Wednesdays they are upset to go to, they do not want to go to school, they are reluctant to go to school because this brake-less car causes a lot of trouble to the other vehicles and other passengers and other even the people on the road. Those who walk on the pavement are also troubled by the brake-less car, and they do not want to see the difficulties and the fun created by the brake-less car of their mother. And on Wednesdays, children of the parents or other the siblings of Patricia Grace are unwilling to go to school because on Wednesdays their mother goes shopping. So let's just have a little bit of reading from there and here. We are reading the opening of the story. It used to be green once. It used to be green once. We were all ashamed of our mother. Our mother always did things to shame us, like putting red darns in our clothes and cutting old swimming togs and making two girls' togs from the top half for my sister and a boy's togs from the bottom half for my brother. Pity and Rana were crying when Mum made them take the togs to school. Petty sat down on the road by our gate and yelled out she wasn't going to school. She wasn't going swimming. It didn't blame my sister. I didn't blame my sister because the togs were 38 chests and Petty was only 10. But Mum knew how to get her up off the road. She yelled loudly, "Get up off that road, my girl. There is nothing wrong with these togs." I didn't have any togs when I was a kid and I had to swim in my nothings. "Get up off your backside and get to school." Mum's got a loud voice and she knew how to shame us. We all dragged Petty off the road before our mates came along and heard Mum. We pushed Petty into the school bus so Mum wouldn't come yelling up the drive. So this is very, very funny. The mother, she is very, very outspoken. She speaks loudly. And of course, they do not want, the children do not want other students to hear what the mother talk, which is, of course, very open. Like, I didn't have any talks when I was a kid. I had to swim in my nothingness. All this is quite shameful for the children, and they did not want to spend too much time with their mother in the presence of the other children because their mother is outspoken and she speaks loudly, and it could be creating a lot of insult and pain and shame to the children. Now, other than that, we can understand. Now I'm going to read one more paragraph from the story from which we understand the poverty of the children. "We never minded our holy fruit at first. Dad used to pick up the cases of overripe apples or pears from town that he got cheap. Mum would dig out the rotten bits and then give them to us to take for play lunch. We didn't notice much at first, not until Reverty from down the road yelled out to us one morning, 'Hey, you fellows, who shot your pears?' We didn't have anywhere to hide our lunch because we weren't allowed school bags until we go to high school. Mum said she wasn't buying 14 school bags. When we went to high school, we could have shoes too. The whole lot of us gave Revati a good hiding after school." So this shows the poor background of the children, the parents compelling them to take cheap fruits because it's difficult for them to buy first quality fruit, and they just take the holy fruit during the play lunch, and other children ridicule them. Now we have the instance of the car given to them by their uncle, and we have the reason why uncle gives the car to them. "Uncle Ross gave us the car because he couldn't fix it up anymore, and he had been fined because he lived in Oakland." Okay, so the car is no more going to be used in the city, and he is going to be punished. Uncle Ross is going to be punished in the city. He is in Oakland, and uncle gives the car to their dad. because he gave the car to Dad, so we could drive our cream cans up the road instead of pushing them up the wheelbarrow. Now we have a lot of fun and comedy created by the car that is given to their dad and mom. And Wednesday's mom drives this car to the shop for shopping, of course, and it is creating more and more fun. And now we have a very, very important incident in the story, because one day when the children come back, their parents are very, very jubilant. They are dressed in their good clothing. They are laughing and smiling and jumping up and down. And children ask their parents, "Why? What happened? Why are you laughing? What are you laughing at, Dad? Why are you dressed up for? What are you dressed up for? Hey, Mom, what's the matter with Dad? Your dad's a rich man," she said. "Your dad is just won $50,000 in a lottery." Okay, so fortunately for them, their dad won a $50,000 lottery, and they have plenty of money, and with this money they are just going to buy new dress, new shoes, new school bus, new food, and of course they are going to buy a new car. And we have the continuation of the story. I'm not going to read out the entire story. Now I'm just going to sum up. So they buy a new car, and now we have to look at the life of the parents and children after winning the $50,000 lottery. So children change a lot, but parents do not change, because their mom on Wednesdays used to sound the horn of the old car, reminding or just informing people in the neighborhood that she is going to the city for shopping. So all those people in the neighborhood depended on their mom, Patricia Gray's mom, for shopping. They used to ask her to buy some potato, some maybe some clothing like shirts or trousers, or they even used to ask her to buy some food, edible items, like all kinds of provisions, were all kinds of grocery, stationery items were bought by their mom, because their mom is having a car. And we have to understand that people in the neighborhood, they are poor, so she is helping them by buying things for them, stationery items and grocery items, and of course even half-cooked items. Okay, and that was when she was having the old car. And now, after winning the $50,000, she continues the same habit. She is going for shopping on Wednesdays, she is sounding the horn, she is getting the list from the people in the neighborhood, she is taking them inside the car, they go together in the new car. And of course it's a Chevrolet green car, and from this new Chevrolet car comes the title, "It used to be green once." And at the end of the shopping on Wednesdays, we can't see the car because the car is overloaded. It is completely covered with goods she bought from the city. And she has to, of course, be seated on the driver's seat with difficulty, because all around the driver, there are goods, vegetables, stationery items and all. And you have to just, it is very difficult for you to understand the color of the car. And from that comes the title, "It used to be green once." Okay, so it's a beautiful, wonderful, semi-autobiographical kind of a short story by Patricia Grace, the Maori writer from New Zealand in English, which helps us understand the life of the Maori people in New Zealand. Now, with this introduction, we are looking at the questions and answers. We have questions in page number 101. First, we look at the multiple choice questions. How many children did Mum and Dad have? Mum and Dad have 14 children. Question number two, how did the fruits become holy? The rotten parts were dug out. Question number three, why did the children ask the driver to stop the bus when they saw mom approaching? Because mom had no brakes, or mom's car had no brakes, and she used to ask the driver to stop the school bus. And the next question, but then one day something happened that changed everything. What happened? Okay, that changed everything is their dad won a lottery of $50,000. Now we have short questions. Answer the questions in a sentence or two. Why did Petty hate swimming at school? Petty hated swimming at school because their mother used to alter the old clothing, and Petty was only 10 years. She was very small, and she was given a togue, a swimming suit, which was 38 chest size. And we can understand, even adults, some of the adults do not have 38 chest size. And this is, of course, quite shameful for her, because the togue or the swim suit doesn't suit her, and Petty hated swimming at school. Now the next question, second question, why did Uncle Raj give Dad his car? We have the answer in page number 95. Uncle Raj gave us the car because he couldn't fix it up anymore, and he had been fined because he lived in Oakland, and now the car cannot be used anymore in Oakland. It has no brake, and he gives the car to the parents of Patricia Grace. Why did mom toot the horns of the car on Wednesday mornings when she was out on the road? Mom sounded the horns of the car on Wednesday mornings when she was going for shopping, because the car did not have any brake, and of course, if she did not give some indication to the other vehicles as well as other people on the road to remain away from the way of the car, it would have led to some accident like collision. And mom used to sound the horn of the car. Okay, so we have to move on to the next question. Now we are in page number 102. The question is, which was the only accident that mom ever had in her car? That is in page number 97 and 98. We hear from the story that mom never ever had an accident in her car, except for one. Once when she threw a side of mutton out to Uncle Petya, it knocked him over and broke his leg. So this is the only one accident. She's throwing out a leg of or a side of a goat, and it hitting Uncle Petya, and he broke his leg. Now the next question, how is Mr. Hartley, the Pakeha teacher, presented in the story? Pakeha is the Maori word for white English settlers in New Zealand, and Mr. Hartley is their new teacher, new English teacher, white teacher in the school. And the teacher, Mr. Hartley, is presented as a gentleman. We have the answer in page number 98. I'm reading. After a while, we started walking home from school on Wednesdays to give mom a good chance of getting home before us, and so we wouldn't be in the bus when it had to stop and let her pass. The boys didn't like having to walk home, but we girls didn't mind because Mr. Hartley walked home too. He was a new teacher at school, and he stayed not far from where we lived. We girls thought he was really neat. We understand that Mr. Hartley was gentleman. Now next question, how could Dad buy a new car? Dad could buy a new car because Dad won $50,000 lottery. Next question, list a few things mom did that shamed her children. Okay, we have plenty of things that their mother did to shame them. Number one is mother alters old dresses and ask the children to wear them and often these new dresses are prepared by altered or knitted by their mom is not suitable for them, like Petty, who is just 10 years, has to wear a top of 38 chest size, and it is rather very shameful for them. And number two is often their mother speaks very loudly and she shares how she lived her life to the children, and that again causes a lot of shame to them. She doesn't care for what she says or who listens to it, and she speaks like when she was in school, she didn't have any toes and she had to swim in her nothingness. And of course, now the third incident is the incident of the use of the car that is given to them by their uncle Ross, which has no brake, and mothers shopping and driving, and loud sounding of the horn, and all this is very, very funny, and of course it is causing a lot of shame to the children. So these are the few things that their mother did and which caused so much of shame to the children. Now we come to the paragraph questions. What picture of the mother do you get by the end of the story? Okay, the mother is of course an ideal mother, or a very good mother and a very good human being. This is the picture we get. Say for example, mother in the story, she lives her life for the family, she lives her life for the society, she lives the life for the people. Number one, she is impoverished, she is poor, she loves her husband, she supports her husband, she loves her children, and she doesn't care for herself. She has given birth to 14 children. She's looking after them. She's poor and she has a lot of difficulty. She's struggling to bring up the children. And she tries her best to adjust with whatever she has. And we can see that it is very difficult for people to bring up 14 children. And they struggle, and this mother is struggling and struggling and struggling. Despite of the impoverished background, she's giving education to the 14 children, encouraging them, motivating them, guiding them. And this is of course what a mother has to do, and she is an ideal mother. She's also a very good wife, and she does everything in the family. She does the cooking, she does the laundry, she helps the children, she helps them in their studies, she's encouraging them, she does the shopping, and she does whatever she can do for people in the neighborhood. Despite of winning the lottery, she doesn't change her lifestyle at all. She's still the same lady, with the same kind of hard work, same kind of attitude, sympathy, empathy, helping and sharing attitude. So this mother in the story, It Used to Be Green, once is an ideal mother and an ideal citizen. With this, we can come to the next question. How did the winning of the lottery affect the parents and the children? Their father wins a $50,000 lottery, and this dollar of course doesn't change the parents much. Of course, they buy some new dress because they need to have new dress, and they buy some good food, they need to have that too. They buy of course some all that they required for the family. They buy a new car. Now they also make a better shed for the cow, the cattle, and all this is necessary. And other than that, they don't change. Despite of winning $50,000, a huge amount, the attitude of the parents towards themselves and others in the neighborhood doesn't change. They still lead the same kind of life, they do the same kind of things, and they do of course whatever they can for the others. The mother continues, and now she's asking people in the neighborhood to take ride with her, asking them to visit her, asking them also to join her to go shopping and all. So parents do not change. They still lead the same life, But children, children like, because we can't blame the children at all, because children see other children in their school, in their classes, they would bring good food, good clothing, good bags, good shoes, and they see all that, and they could be having some kind of inferiority feeling when they don't have it. And now that their father win a lottery, they change their lifestyle, they are dressed very well, they eat good food, and of course they change a little bit in their attitude, but I'm sure they are not going to change their character and conduct. They are going to have the same good character of their parents, helping others and all. But their lifestyle, like good, they wear good dress, they have good food. This is what they should have. And when you have food, of course, you buy good food, good dress, right? But we can understand that there is, of course, no change for the parents. And now we come to the next question. Discuss the symbolism of the car in the story. The car in the story is a symbol of movement, progress on one side, and on the other side, it's a symbol of a lot of values. We have two cars in the story. One car is the old car that was bequeathed to them by their uncle Russ. The second car is the green car they bought after winning the $50,000, and the car is a symbol of movement, progress, and the stoic kind of attitude. Because these people, they are struggling a lot, and they have to do a lot of things, and they are doing a lot of things, and this car is of course a great help for them. Despite of difficulties, despite of impoverished background, they work hard, and the car is of course very helpful. Their mom can use it for shopping. Their dad can of course shift the dairy products from place to place. So it's very useful to them. And besides that, of course, they use the car for the society, the community, and the car is a symbol of empathy, sympathy, love, sharing attitude, kindness. Okay, so this is to a certain extent what unite the people. Now that their mother has this old car, okay, it's she can use it for buying things for others. Okay, and it is of course a symbol of maybe you shouldn't give up. You shouldn't give up, right? It's a symbol of hope. Yeah, it's a symbol of hope. Say, for example, it's old, very old, and it has no brake, and still they use it. Still they use it. This is maximum utilization. They are hopeful that one day we are going to replace this car. So till we replace it, we will use this with whatever difficulties, with whatever troubles and problems. It has no brake. Still they are going to use it. Okay, and that's it, right? So maximum utilization. We will try our best to use. And they don't have any, it's again a symbol of their willingness to accept what they have. Sometimes people suffer from so much of inferiority feeling, and maybe you would just hide yourself, but these people, they don't hide it. This is old, but it's useful, and we will use it until it is no more useful, and before it is becoming useless, they are having the lottery, $50,000, and they buy the new car. And new car again is symbolic of love, caring attitude, consideration, sharing, sympathy, empathy, etc. And that shows the broad-mindedness. The cars, both the cars, old car and the new car, show the broad-mindedness, the openness, the readiness to help us, others, the sharing attitude of the parents. And of course, it is symbolic of the values in the Maori community. Now we come to the next question. Why the children hate Wednesdays? Answer is simple and easy. Wednesdays are the days on which their mother goes shopping. And when she goes shopping, she uses the car which has no brake, and she is sounding the car for other vehicles and passengers to be very careful. And all this is causing so much of fun and laughter in the others, and the children are of course very, very ashamed, or they hated Wednesdays. Sometimes they try not to go to school by pretending that they are having some sickness, right? So the reason is the driving of the old car by mom, and it is leading to a lot of fun, and maybe it leads to accidents too. Now the next question, how does the story convey Maori consciousness? The story very effectively and perfectly conveys the Maori consciousness, the consciousness of the Maori people. They live like one community. One community is one family, and everything in the community is shared. What is significant is the society. What is significant is the other people. What is important is relationship. You have to care for the other person. You have to care for the other people. And you have to share everything. You share everything, and the other people are like the members of your own family. And here in the story, we see the mother of the narrator, Patricia Grace, is trying her best to help the others. She shares everything, buys things for them, lets the others ride in their car. All this is very, very, we understand that this is, of course, the way Maori people live their life. And it is conveying, the story is conveying the Maori consciousness. And this is, of course, a story with so much of positivity. Despite of poverty, despite of difficulty, they don't complain. They just work hard. They educate themselves, educate children, and hard work and education is taking them to better days, wealth and prosperity and peace. Now we have the essay questions. Answer the following questions in no more than 300 words. Discuss the humor in the story. Examine the narration in the story. Humor, the story is a very humorous story. From beginning till the end, you have a lot of humor. Humor arises from the activities of their mother. Say, for example, the mother is compelling the children to wear old dresses or other dress that doesn't suit them. And the car and the dialogues of the mother, and of course, how she is throwing things, how she is sounding the car, how she is asking other vehicles and other people to remain away from the road. And we have, of course, the scene of the winning of the lottery. And there again, we have some humor there. So it is, of course, a wonderful. And again, children and other children in the school, their dialogues and their deeds leading to a lot of humor again. And the narration. Narration is, of course, from the point of view of Patricia Grace, small child. Patricia Grace is, we will listen to the perspective or point of view of a school girl, Patricia Grace. And Patricia Grace is just sharing her own school days experience of school days in this story. She tells us how her parents lived, how they were brought up, what all difficulties they had, their real family experience with their mother, experience with other students, experience with the teacher, the struggles they had as children. They didn't have any good food, they didn't have any clothing, they didn't have any bag, school bag or shoes or anything. But very suddenly, fortunately for them, everything changes. And all this is narrated from the point of view of Patricia Grace. And it is very realistically presented. It is narrated in the chronological order. Incident 1 followed by incident 2, of course, last incident in such a way, very chronological, linear narration, very realistic story in which we understand the life of the Maori people and life of the Maori people in the community. And we also understand that there is so much of truth and fact in the story, because everything is narrated as it is. And we understand that this can be autobiographical or semi-autobiographical. And the story is becoming all the more interesting and beautiful, because we have a lot of original names and expressions, like Maori expressions and Maori names and dialogues. So all the dialogues within inverted commas in the story is making the story all the more beautiful. Okay, and very real presentation, representation of the way, very graphic and vivid presentation. So each and every character, like Uncle Ras, then Mr. Hadley, and the students and children and the siblings, everybody is realistic, and no reader is going to forget the characters. So it is, of course, a beautiful story, beautiful narration. So with this, we come to the end of the discussion of Patricia Gray's beautiful story, It Used to Be Green Once. Thanks a lot for listening. Study very well and accomplish all your dreams. May God bless you. Bye-bye.